everybody. Thank you for joining us today for our webinar, How Do Arts and Culture Make a Difference? We're presenting this in partnership with Americans for the Arts Animating Democracy Program. There are a lot of conversations happening in our sector right now around how we best measure and share the impact of the arts in Ontario. And I'm really grateful that Animating Democracy co-director Barbara Schaefer-Bacon is joining us today to present the Continuum of Impact Guide. This is a guide that defines six families of social and civic outcomes that artists and their partners commonly aspire to and achieve through their creative work. These outcome families articulate ways the arts contribute to making change happen. And this webinar introduces the guide as a practical resource to help articulate clear and realistic outcomes that can guide your project design and define indicators or evidence of change that can be observed and measured. So just as a bit of background, in case you don't know, the Ontario Trillium Foundation is an agency of the Government of Ontario, and we're one of Canada's leading grant-making foundations. With a decent budget of over $136 million, we award grants to about 1,000 projects every year. And we're a leading public agency and partner in the public benefits sector. So we've just launched the Knowledge Center, which is an online shared learning environment that will connect the nonprofit sector or Ontario's public benefits sector. We're offering the Knowledge Center as part of our commitment to support Ontario communities beyond simply granting through our services to community work. This online resource includes a discussion forum, access to reports, videos, infographics, and more that will build over time. And this resource library will grow, and we hope with your help. This webinar is actually the second webinar that will go and live on the Knowledge Center in the Inspired People Hub, which is the hub that I host. There are discussion forums centered around our six action areas, so inspired people being one, but also active people, connected people, green people, promising young people, and prosperous people. But we also host discussions around topics important to the sector, so you'll find an evaluation hub, evaluation measurement hub, and an open data hub. The discussion forum is a virtual space for sharing stories, challenges, opportunities, and for learning from each other. And we're really, really excited about the potential of this space, the shared learning environment. This webinar is being recorded, and it will live in the resource library and on the Inspire People Hub. So why is OTF interested in how arts and culture make a difference and our subject matter for today's webinar? This Inspired People Action Area is named for the impact that we'd like to have through our investments in arts, culture, and heritage. And this diagram that you're looking at right now outlines the priority outcomes and grant results that guide our investments. This action area is about enriching people's lives through arts, culture, and heritage. And a key piece of our investments is around moving people from being passive audience members to being active participants in the creative process. It's also based on the premise that participation in quality culture, heritage, and arts experiences leads to more connectedness within communities through an engaged public. Big questions that are emerging in our sector right now, how do we describe what's happening in these arts experiences, and how do we describe the impact the work is having? So today's webinar, I hope, will help people with articulating clear and realistic outcomes that can both guide project design and define indicators or evidence of change that can be observed and measured. And I know from looking at who's joining us today, there's a really incredible mix of folks from practitioners, individual artists, organizations, funders, policymakers. So it will be really interesting to hear how the information in this workshop would be helpful to you in the work that you're doing. And of course, I will be inviting people to share that on the Knowledge Center afterwards. So last but not least, I'm going to let Barbara take over really soon, but not before I introduce her. Barbara co-directs Animating Democracy, which is a program of Americans for the Arts that inspires, informs, promotes, and connects arts and culture as potent contributors to community, civic, and social change. Additionally, she contributes to local arts advancement work at Americans for the Arts. She's written, edited, and contributed to many, many publications. Some include Civic Dialogue, Arts and Culture, Findings from Animating Democracy, The Artistic Imagination as a Force for Civic Dialogue, Arts and Civic Engagement, a Toolkit, Fundamentals of Local Arts Management, and the Cultural Planning Work Kit. A consultant in program design and evaluation, Barbara has served as an advisor for state and national arts agencies and private foundations. And Barbara previously served as executive director of the Arts Extension Service at the University of Massachusetts. She's president of the Arts Extension Institute and a board member for Women Arts. Barbara served for 14 years in the Belchertown, Massachusetts School Committee, and she currently serves as a member of the Massachusetts Cultural Council. And Barbara is joining us today from Massachusetts. And Barbara, I'm handing the controls over to you.
Great, thank you. Just a second to get us all up and running here. Hi, everyone. I'm really happy to be here and to share the Continuum Guide. We're really delighted with the interest in assessment and evaluation and to feel that it's kind of on the rise because nobody really wants to talk about it and it's very hard to commit the time, effort, and resources to do it. But as we take ourselves more seriously about the value and impact that we can bring to communities and the difference that we can make, it's really important that we all commit to evaluation. So Liz and to Trillium, thanks so much for having me. Although we don't have audio connection, I really hope that we can make a give and take and some dialogue today. So I really do encourage you to add questions and even comments that we can share. It'll interrupt my voice, among other things, and it'll deepen the conversation, which I think is great. What I'm introducing to you is a guide focused on a continuum of impact that you see in front of you, and that will be our touchstone today. We're going to kind of take a walking tour. The intent of the webinar is really to introduce the resource to you. It's a part of a lot of resources that we've tried to develop and to put together. We've really been working to drive evaluative thinking and evaluation practice for a number of reasons, because we do take the work that you all do and that we're all engaged in seriously, and I think if we do take it seriously, we have to be concerned about the choices we're making, the efficacy of the work, the way that we're investing in ourselves. We have to want to know the answer. We work often with a wonderful evaluator from New Hampshire, Chris Dwyer, and she has also been a public service servant. She has been a select person in the city of Manchester, of Portsmouth, New Hampshire. And she said, you know, when the fire department cares about their performance, they're looking at how can they shave 3 seconds off a call to reach a fire. And they're that concerned that they're looking that closely at how they can improve their work. And so we should challenge ourselves to do that. But we also believe that the idea of evaluative thinking, of really thinking at the outset of our work, what kinds of outcomes we're looking for, what would be indications of change, that the act of doing that, especially with partners and stakeholders in our work, can immediately begin to change the environment where evidence can be identified, collected, organized, and utilized. And while we're talking about evaluation, we're not only talking about quantitative evaluation that is all about metrics and numbers. In fact, we'll talk very quickly about how to draw on our own creative resources to be doing the active data collection itself and analysis. And so look forward to some of the best work in that particular arena is coming from Canada. So we'll be talking about that. So we get into this work really in response to frequently heard concerns from practitioners who feel overwhelmed about what it might take to do credible evaluation, to figure out whose standards they're trying to address, to figure out which evidence is worth looking for and how to document or track that activity to get to those hard-to-measure outcomes. We're concerned also because the outcomes that we often can produce are what might be termed by other fields intermediary outcomes. So if you're trying to change a policy, we do help contribute to policy change and to change in conditions, but one of the ways that we might do that is by building the creative leadership skills of youth in a community. And we need to stop and also look at that change as well. Becomes very important. And as we looked at our at the work that was being done in the arena of evaluation, what we saw was that we were seeing the claims that art saves lives, that art transforms things. And we know that we can talk about cultural practices that bring people together, cultural organizing that mobilizes people, artists that can really activate the social imagination so new ideas can be possible, can be entertained. And this potency of art as a catalyst for civic change, social change, it's observed, but we really do struggle to measure it. And so we wanted to focus on how we could help get to more specificity in the way that we can describe and talk about the outcomes of our work. And that got us focused on thinking about specific outcomes and in particular the indicators that we could track to identify the change that we're seeking. And that's where the guide is really focused and where we're going to spend some time. You can see that what we hope that the continuum is really best positioned to do is help you really think about outcomes in clear ways, indicators that can be identified, planning and data collection. So that's where our focus is. I want to mention to everyone that we took a guide that is in a certain kind of a graphical design, and it got kind of stretched for wide screens. So if you are, over 25 and you think your eyesight just took a dive, it's a little bit fuzzy. So I apologize for that. I didn't really realize until I saw it on the big screen today that it might be that. So as you're thinking about the focus here of the work, I wanted to start with a story, and the story comes from Portland, Maine, also in New England, and the work of an artist named Marty Pottinger and her project in Portland called Art at Work. Marty has a nonprofit called Terremoto, and she settled herself in the city of Portland, Maine, with a theory of change, that the biggest asset in any city is its human capital, the residents and the city workers. And that as one of humanity's core elements and engines is creativity, she imagined what if local government could connect to creativity within its own workers while they were forming policies and delivering services and thinking about practical ways to advance the work of the city. And she went to work to create a project, a first project, that was called the Police Poetry Project, working with the Portland police who were having a lot of difficulty with morale and a lot of difficulty with community relations, and convinced a wonderful sergeant to bring in other local artists, poets and photographers to begin to work with police to help them express their lives and their work through poetry and document it through photography. And the outcome of that was a police poetry calendar that featured the creative work of the officers and the photography that they took. The Police Poetry Project created a visual and an opportunity, a platform at poetry readings around the city for the community to be reintroduced to the police in a very personal and real way. The officers worked with local artists to write poetry about their work. They shared them in this calendar and through readings and dialogues that the readings helped to create a platform for. The aim of the project was very directed at the challenges the department had articulated, a need for improved morale and need to improve public perception of police. So the story that I bring you is really brought to the fore when a few years after the project, the City of Portland wins an RCAM grant from our National Endowment for the Arts. And at the press conference to announce the grant, the mayor is present, the police, now assistant police chief, the sergeant who stepped up to the project, are all there, and they are talking about the outcomes that they have seen from art at work. And the police chief is saying, after 4 years, I couldn't be more impressed with the outcomes we've had in the community, within our hallways and personally. Interaction with the community has certainly improved. This project has allowed the citizens to see the police officers beyond the uniform as human beings with feelings and thoughts. The mayor speaks and says, our city workers and the things that they deal with on a day-to-day basis, they've been able to express those through art, and presenting their art to the community has created a bridge for them to the rest of the community. So the evidence, Marty's focus on the specific concerns of agencies in the city government, her theory of change, and really working with her stakeholders to think about the change that would be meaningful to them, ultimately allowed her to collect the kind of evidence to demonstrate, as is said on her website, art making is a valuable, cost-effective, sustainable vehicle for strengthening cross-cultural understanding, enhancing communication, raising morale, and increasing understanding and cooperation between city agencies and the public. And so I bring that story to light, and I'll refer back to it a few times perhaps in this, because in that particular instance, Marty worked with an evaluator, with Chris Dwyer, whom I mentioned, and at the outset of the police poetry project, they really began to imagine how they would structure the project, identify clear outcomes, and create a data collection plan for the project. And that plan allowed Marty to collect data in many low-key, low-tech ways that gave her the evidence that she needed to substantiate the change. So with that, I want to begin to our tour of the guide. And I'm eager for other stories like that that can help us understand how we can use different kinds of documentation. In the case of Marty, the grant award itself was some evidence of the success of the work, the testimonials being given by civic leaders, those were also able to be substantiated with some specific kinds of numbers that she was able to collect. So here we go. What made change happen? We want to get specific. And the continuum of impact really provides an opportunity to fill in the blank between the art saves lives and policy change. In conventional program evaluation for a performance or an artist residency, we generally document numbers of participants and audience members. Look at their response to the programs. But because civic engagement and the creation of human and social and community capital are really acknowledged as the place where the arts make perhaps some of their greatest contribution, it's really important for us to understand the effects of our work and to step up. And so these kinds of effects include heightened awareness or deepened knowledge or understanding of civic and social issues, The ability to understand or relate to others' perspectives and other situations. And so that's what we see now if we go back to the continuum. Oops, sorry about that, folks. You can see that we identified what people know, how people communicate, what they are thinking and feeling, how they are, what they know and how they can use resources, their capacities to act, the actions that they take and the conditions that are changed by the work. These are the places where we make many contributions, and our ability to really place our work on the continuum, to begin to say, this is really what we're working to do, and then begin to get really particular and specific about those things that we're trying to change, and the indicators of them allows us to collect the data that we need. I want to make the point that this continuum was intentionally put on a wavy line because it's not always linear, and we don't always do only one thing. So your project or program might really be addressing several points on this continuum, and one, there may be something very cyclical going on where your ability to affect attitudes prompts action, which helps to build knowledge. And so you might think first about a particular project or the overall mission of your organization or your work and say, what's the real difference? What's the most important difference we're trying to make? And just that what's most important begins to narrow your focus a little bit so that you don't have to worry about everything, but really keeps them focus on those things that you want to be sure you're understanding. It's not that we want to ignore the unintended outcomes of our work. In fact, we want to capture them. But we do want to invest energy, time, and resources in the things that will really make a difference going forward. And that is best done with our partners and stakeholders, understanding what matters to them and what they consider to be important. I'm really happy and want to encourage folks to, if they have some questions about the nature of the continuum or what might be there or not be there, I'm happy to hear those questions. I'll mention that if you look at the linear order of the actions, they actually follow what a lot of people consider the way that community organizing works. You build knowledge and you really get people's awareness going, you create discourse, you start to, whether in a disruptive or a deepening way, increase the amount of discourse and the quality of discourse around issues, working to change hearts as well, and, as well as minds in terms of what people think and feel. You're activating people to act on their own behalf, organizing for action so that the people that have the most at stake are in the leadership role, are leading the charge. You move actions and you really pay attention to the conditions and changes that you're making so that they can be sustained. So it can be understood in a linear fashion, but it doesn't have to be worked in a linear fashion. And we've already stopped here, so I'm going to look here. And so the progress that we're really talking about is a progression of thinking first about the outcomes in these families of outcomes, and we're going to explore them, to think about the results that we're looking for. And that could be your results with a particular group that you're working with, your project as a whole, your program overall, or the cumulative effect of your organizational activity. Outcomes really are, could be aimed at any of those levels from individual to system. The indicators are what's observable or measurable as evidence of change. A lot of people talk about the goal here is to develop a culture of evidence that we notice those things that point to us and demonstrate the progress that sometimes we feel internally or we notice ourselves, but we're not so sure that's going to be meaningful to someone else. but in fact, lots of things collected add up often. So the indicators help us to understand progress, and collecting data is the way that we show that evidence. We're going to talk about data collection, but I want to spend some time with the indicators first, and then we'll come back. The guide offers the basics around collecting data and points to many other resources, and we'll talk about others of those as well. So I want to just do a Canadian shout out to Jubilee's Theatre that has been really focused and working on saying that the arts have a place in evaluation, that creative activity skills and approaches are really useful in evaluation, both in terms of data collection and in terms of assessment and analysis. They've done some terrific work, so don't put your creative skills aside when it comes to data collection. Get creative. And now we'll dive in. So the outcomes and indicators in these families, we need to look deeply in each one to see where we are trying, what kind of a difference are we really trying to make. Pam and I have worked with a number of projects that the most interesting part of the work is often a group of different stakeholders that are working together where a creative center, a core about something. So an example, we were working in Philadelphia with a commissioned play intended to tell the story of disability rights movement centered in the city of Philadelphia and the state of Pennsylvania. And invited to the table to the project that was this play and the dialogue they hoped to create were many advocacy groups for disability. The laws in terms of disability access were 25 years old. We were past the time of the people that really were the organizers to get those laws passed. And so it was really in conversation with them that the meaningful outcomes from this project could be determined. And we learned in communication with them that they really felt they needed to tell the story again because awareness and knowledge around disability rights had dropped. We found out that they felt they needed to really engage new leaders because it was often parents of those with disability, especially intellectual disability, that had been the crusaders, that had fought the good fight, and those parents are aging, and there's a movement of self-advocacy, and so skill and action in a new generation of leadership was really important. And lastly, that there were additional systems and policies still to be worked on. So helping us, so thinking with them, helped us to see the places that we really wanted to pay some attention. As you see over to the right, what the guide offers are some worksheets. The worksheets are not magic potions that get you to an evaluation plan. They're really the basis for you to work with your stakeholders and peers to document and to go through the process of articulating them. And we'll go on. Before I charge into knowledge, Liz, are there any questions that folks have raised so far that we should take up?
I don't have any questions so far.
Okay.
Yeah, we can just keep going.
All right. We'll just dive in. So in each case of each family, the guide helps you to think more specifically about the kinds of changes we might be talking about. So this first family is around awareness, knowledge, and understanding. We were trying to increase the awareness of people to help them assess choices, make informed decisions, take actions that are in their best interest and in the common good. And so what does it mean to say we're really trying to improve knowledge and awareness? What could we be looking for in terms of change? And how could we, what kinds of indicators would help us? So if we were trying to say we're doing some campaigns and we want to know if those campaigns made a difference, we can look at a number of things that help us to understand if there is a response to the campaign, if the campaign is spreading out further from where we started. And so if we want to understand, we might see if there are additional campaigns that are launched as a result of ours. If there's response and comment and activity in social media or in other forums. If forums are raised, if the newspaper is starting to cover an issue that they had not been covering before. If there are donations to agencies that are working around those issues and causes. Those are all ways that we can begin to see or measure how awareness is being built. And it brings me right away to one of the main points that I would make about all of this, which is it's pretty hard to see change unless you have a baseline. And so one of the important steps in any of these areas or families of outcome is to ask yourself, how can we establish what's going on right now to understand what change, what would be an indicator of change, what would be different than now? We need to start with that baseline. And there are sometimes data sources that can provide that baseline information, but in lieu of those, the best way is to start with the kind of a meeting where folks get to describe the conditions that they currently see. And that's a very useful meeting in terms of also asking the question, what would be an indicator of change that would be meaningful to you? And so I think there's lots of sophisticated work that can be done with the help of researchers and professional evaluators to establish formal baselines. But in your own work, it might just be to establish that baseline. And I'll give you an example of this. You may or may not know a group that operates in Skid Row in Los Angeles, California, called LAPD. In this case, it's the LAPD, Los Angeles Poverty Department, a theater company. And LAPD has been working and making theater in Skid Row for over 25 years. They went out and in sort of a backcasting way and interviewed many, many of the social service agencies that had been partners to the work of LAPD over many years, and asked them to describe, in retrospect, what was the difference that LAPD had made in the work that they saw. And what they learned in their interviews was that most all of those social service agencies had developed art and theater programs within their social services, that the seeing the work and seeing the evidence themselves of what difference the arts made encouraged them to add their own programs. So I just use that as both a demonstration of how you can collect valid evidence, but also if you can imagine having described the conditions in Skid Row prior to establishing LAPD, we might have said, no art is happening. There is not an outlet for creative expression for the residents in any places. So we can begin to see the difference that makes. Again, I won't go through every ounce of this thoroughly, but I want you to sort of think about how you can be walking yourself through the piece. You might start looking at the continuum and say, which of the areas, the families, do we want to be working in? And then use these lists to help you imagine ways that you could, where's the place you really are trying to make a difference. So in terms of knowledge, you know, how much do people understand? How much do they make reference to data and information? Many times our theory, our plays, our films, our artworks are intended to actually convey a good deal of information. And so how can we be set up to see how well people are using that information themselves afterwards or applying it in some way? And lastly, understanding. Understanding often hits on the emotional, so we might learn through stories. In other words, folks may have been a part of a creative project in an arts experience, and it's actually in short interviews or short story circles at the end of the event that you would collect the, you'd have an opportunity to understand how they express deepened or expanded understanding, or an ability to say, this is how I see this now when I saw it differently before. This is a kind of a response that I've had. And so you can begin to build into your programs ways to really collect the direct response of participants in terms of understanding. Again, I'm going to head on to the next frame, and which is discourse. And we won't have time to spend all of that kind of time in each of these, but I wanted to stop at a couple. Again, Liz, if you get questions, please let me know, and we'll stop for a minute.
Will do. I don't have any questions as yet, but if people do have things that are coming up for them, please don't hesitate to send me or the entire group a message by the chat box.
Yeah. Great. So discourse and deliberation. Animating Democracy actually started with a support from the Ford Foundation, completely focused on the intersection of art and civic dialogue, asking questions about how arts projects with intention could create an opportunity for a civic or and civil dialogue. And so discourse and dialogue were areas that we spent a lot of time in our supportive projects early on. And so you can begin to say, yeah, we're working on really improving the discourse, the public discourse. So what does that mean? Well, it might be important to look at who's actually engaged. Where are there opportunities to engage? What's the quality of that engagement? Are opponents able to become involved? Is there a place for actual opponents to speak to one another? Will they agree to participate in dialogue? Is it sustained? What's the frequency? And we can think about discourse in a broader sense in terms of what's happening in the media. Are we affecting the content of what's being reported and described? Are we affecting who has access to media and the ability to be represented and have their views put out? The quality of commentary or reporting, the incidence of bias. And again, you can begin to, these are related to outcomes of creative projects. So depending on where you're really aimed, that would be the thing. In one project, as an example, a local arts council was really trying to posit that artists and that the creative and cultural organizations in the community could be assisting a community that was very interested in improving civic engagement and civic dialogue in that community. And so they held some training led by artists to teach lots of creative approaches to engage people in dialogue that didn't look like a town meeting or a public hearing. But created a whole lots of other ways that issues could be addressed and folks could come to the table. They worked on with the groups on how to do a better job at extending invitations on and creating settings in their facilities and institutions. But the aim was that the city would see the arts as a key player, really, in dialogue, in creating dialogue settings and being good catalysts. So the outcome that they described was that art spaces and programs are regularly used for dialogue and civic engagement. And so two indicators that they identified were that the number of arts-based dialogue programs with artists' involvement increased, and so obviously they needed a baseline. And second, that community development corporations, that folks other than arts organizations were calling on artists to be involved in their community engagement projects. And again, they could kind of track that by referral and so on. They could also talk and interview the community development agencies about their satisfaction with it. But all of that started with creating a training program or an introductory program that brought people into seeing those creative resources as an asset in that setting. And I'm going to head on. So attitude or values, aspiration, motivation, there's a lot in this particular family that we do speak of frequently. A great public mural or a civic event can begin to change the way people see a space in a community, can begin to change the sense of what's possible and build aspiration in meaningful ways. And so we can look at how people express those possibilities, sense of new direction, hope, what's changed, what they would describe as changed. So you can imagine a project that goes in and interviews perhaps folks, teens, folks in senior centers, captures some of the sense of what is challenging the community and what is enabling a change in a community. And all of that is background that helps you to create a particular arts event or a visual or celebration or festival. And then at that event, you can really be talking with people or creating creative spaces within that event that begin to let people speak themselves about what they're feeling or seeing. And the same is true around opinions and beliefs, around positions on an issue. So often we offer people a chance for empathy, a chance to see something in a different point of view, a chance to actually express values and step outside of sort of those kinds of phrases that just kind of roll off your tongue without thought. But we do a good job very often through creative means of allowing people to really step in to articulate their values more personally, to identify with shared values. So we can begin to say, we want to know if that's happened, how can we look at that? I'm going to move ahead. Again, I'll take a break. In terms of values, and we might think about a sense of people feeling valued in a community, that they're appreciated. And an example of a project in that case was an artist who identified in a fairly homogeneous community of mostly single-family homes, but there were two trailer parks, and that the trailer parks where folks were living, folks seemed really not so connected to the rest of the community, didn't think of themselves in the same way, didn't have the same agency. So the artist created an opportunity for a resident cleanup and signage project where he engaged youth in imagining signs at the gates of the mobile home parks and a big cleanup project in which he invited folks from outside of the trailer parks to come and really help in the effort. He really described that what he was after and what the mobile home park residents were after were that the residents should feel included and respected. The project resulted literally in this great sign competition that was appreciated by the whole town, and then he saw the project through by the signs that the home parks selected being created in beautiful wood carvings to look like the kinds of signs you see at any housing development had a really special feel. So his indicators for change were that a public meeting of the town in the mobile home park was actually attended by the residents and that other community members came to, that there was an increased number of more positive interactions between park residents and other community residents. And he was able to achieve that through understanding of that through a focus group. And that there was an indicator also of the expressions of pride. And so he did some gathering of the kinds of photographs and things that people were taking of themselves and their families near the sign, evidence he collected, photographic evidence of the actual cleanup of different trailers within the trailer park to show the difference in people starting to care for their own homes in a different way.
I just wanted to take a moment to say that these are really fantastic examples that are really kind of really illustrating how you can take some of these indicators and really begin to look at them in terms of actual evaluation. So thank you for that.
That's great. Any questions or anything, any thoughts yourself, Liz?
I think, sometimes evaluating some of these indicators can be very challenging. I'm wondering if there's one that you've noticed people find particularly challenging, and maybe you could share an example of how a project approached evaluating those indicators.
I think that a good example might be we happen to have the change in capacity slide up, and I will say that if you look at this particular slide, the change in capacity in terms of social capital, skills that are measured, artistic and creative capacity, resources, we do a lot of work in this area. I think this is one of the areas that is perhaps less troublesome because we work in this area a great deal. A lot of our programs, our youth arts development programs, opportunities for seniors to really sustain their social skills, they are transformation projects that are really activating citizens on their own behalf. And so this is a place where we spend a lot of our time. And so I would just urge folks to really be thinking a lot about that. I think it is, it's probably more in the shifts in attitude and those earlier pieces around values understanding because it is kind of hard to take the time at the right moment to collect real information and evidence. But sometimes I think we're afraid to do it. So in the case of the disabilities play, we were there was an additional exhibition that was one of the pieces of that project. They created an exhibition that was looking at the specific history of several residential treatment centers, which in the end were condemned and closed. That was an important part of the story of how the laws began to change. But there are also several facilities that have not yet closed and have been improved. And so they were dealing with stakeholders that were very concerned about the story that would be told. They were dealing with having the story told from the participants' point of view. That is, people with intellectual disabilities there were beautiful large-scale photographs and recordings of their talking about their lives, home. They were really the testimony. So it was a complex, I would say, exhibition with a complex and difficult message that could be interpreted in many ways. They ended and it was set in the State House. It was designed to go into the Pennsylvania State House, which meant a sort of large public rotunda that people use just to get from one place to the other. And so it wasn't like a gallery. It had a lot of just challenges. And so at first they were like saying, well, you know, there's not a lot we can do. There's really not a lot we can do. But we developed a survey, and we developed it with some real support from folks who had a sense of what these issues might mean. I'm not able to call up the survey to refer to some of the specifics, but the way that it was dealt with was that we had someone on site for the full week, for a good portion of the full week that the exhibition was up. And we trained two other volunteers, and they literally went with clipboards and asked people who were moving through the exhibition if they could talk with them, and had a small series of questions that gave an opportunity to engage them in conversation, to ask about whether there was a personal resonance about the project, and to sort of check in on the emotional, on the awareness and information knowledge building, et cetera. And then afterwards, they actually went to the staff of the legislatures who were observing the action in the rotunda as they were going about their individual business. So it was a very concentrated effort. It did use a survey, but it was very appropriate, and it actually probably increased the engagement with the exhibition and the quality of the experience of it. And so I think sometimes, you know, rather than thinking of it as being a barrier, if we do evaluation well, sometimes it's actually an asset because it's building the reflective quality into the experience.
That's really fascinating, Barbara, and such an important point I think you make, because I think I've seen many instances where people are concerned that evaluation might actually get in the way of the work of a program, but that's a really great example showing, in fact, that it enhanced the impact of the program.
Yeah, I tend to think that reflection is a luxury. And it's a privilege that not everyone gets. If we don't, we're treating everyone like subjects instead of really full participants. So much of our work is, of course, built on a sense and an assumption almost of participatory evaluation, evaluation that's not privileging observers and experts, but is really intended to help to bring forward the voice of the very people that we really want to be in communication with. And so that's a really important piece. And just looking at time, I'm thinking that we might best be served if I keep moving without going through the specifics, but I hope I've encouraged people to really look specifically at what we offer on these pages. That give you some pointers towards the kind of thing that you could be measuring. You could be looking at whether there are new proposals of policy, at whether they're able to gather support for new policies. These are all things that if we're paying attention, we can look at. So in the guide is a case study that's full and complete and shows how we used all of this to build an evaluation plan. And it's an excellent case study, which I will not go through today because it is there. But it's looking at a project in Pennsylvania, historic Germantown, which is really an African-American neighborhood mostly now. And there is a historic Germantown organization that has is working with about 16 buildings. That historic houses and destinations, and they're trying to preserve and interpret those historic assets and they really increase access to them and understanding of them by the public. So they invited an artist in, and it's a complex project. They invited an artist to engage youth. so that the youth could understand what these resources and assets in their neighborhood were and the stories that related to them, and then that the youth would be the interpreters, the docents, so to speak, to help to share that knowledge and draw other community members in. So the project involved both the engagement of the youth in the history and stories and then their capacity to help to bring the community in. And in the process, the real focus was on the youth building skills. So the case study and these work pages show you exactly what they identified as important outcomes in each family, not all the families, but some of them, and then how they identified what kinds of program they would be doing, and then therefore what kind of data collection method could they use. And I'll just leave it to that because it's all in there for you. Okay, so in each case for every family, you'll see a page like this that just kind of introduces you to what we mean by values attitude in each of the cases, and I'm not going to stay there. So this is a section that you're looking at that is there for one worksheet. And so for the way that we try to make it a useful guide is to help you draft your own strategies around outcomes and indicators for each of these families. So you're going to find in the kit a creative strategy. There's the one that I actually spoke about. You're going to see it played out across the outcomes, what types of outcomes and what are specific expressions of those outcomes. And then it encourages you to begin to write your own. And this is the worksheet that we hope you'll use with other people. And so the guidebook, just to be quick to mention, is all available. I think we provided the link with our promotion for this webinar, but it is available and free to download on our website as well. So here, again, we won't spend too much time because I'm going to do one more story or a bigger story. But we do include this information on ways to collect data. And so really it comes down to that there are really kind of four kinds of things. Talking to people, getting written responses in some form. That often can include surveys but doesn't have to. One of my favorite is just finding existing documentation and data, things that exist outside of what you have to create. And my honest favorite, as in the example of the exhibition, is observation, because those folks who were conducting the surveys also had a small element on their survey, which was just to actually make some observations about how people interacted with the different aspects of the exhibition. They were just literally staying there. So you might just be observing a public meeting that happens on a topic you've been addressing in your creative work. To see what was happening before, what's happening after the fact. So these worksheets, I'll just mention, are PDFs that are writable. That means you could use them, print them, and then you can have a new blank one and start all over again. So there's where we are. And okay, so here is Marty Pottinger. That's her with orange and black check. And she is standing with someone who works at the police department, and she is hanging a beautiful print of one of the printmaking projects that they did in the Art to Work program. Marty has been our poster child for believing in evaluative thinking and really learning how to build a plan. So here's an example. She's really seeing these, she has these beliefs. That art making can increase access to flexible intelligence. You can see the values and the beliefs about art that she has in that list. She very much thinks about who are the audiences for the stories of impact that she's going to tell. Is it community members? Is it unions? Is it arts organizations? Is it funders? Is it the mayor? And ask what are the issues and opportunities they're not just facing and not just thinking about, but really facing what's important to them, and so what information will they find credible. So here are a couple of examples. If the outcome is decreased tension between police and minority youth, then she can say she wants to see police and young people working on joint projects. She wants to see the number of arrests of young people from particular neighborhoods going down. If it's about the city workforce reflecting the community, she wants to see proactive recruitment. She wants to see a candidate pool that includes increasing numbers of women and people of color. So she is really tied into the things that matter to her stakeholders. I'm going to move very quickly through some of this just in light of time. Here we can look at this positive relationship with police and minority youth, and we get specific indicators. More minority youth are signing up for recreational activity. There is minority youth in the police cadet group. There are minority youth actually reporting positive views of the police. It's happening. So in this particular case, she helped the police to create a play, and she helped high schoolers create a play. Each of those plays were probably 12 or 15 minutes long, and they were presented to each other, and then there was discussion and dialogue, and then the police and the youth produced and presented those plays together for publics. If I come back here again, this is related to the picture you're seeing here has to do with the police poetry calendar, and you're seeing an event where the police had done some reading and are now engaged in a dialogue with the community. These are kind of interspersed. You're getting a sense of what that police calendar looked like and what the specific strategies were there. One other thing I'll mention. Yeah.
We had one question come a few slides ago. You had mentioned newcomers, and somebody was asking if they could hear a little bit more about that.
Well, yes. And first of all, I want to see if I can get to that slide. I'm trying to remember if it's here. Yeah, here we go. So first of all, I love that Canada talks about newcomers, and we unfortunately still use words like immigrants, refugees, and aliens in the worst-case scenario. So in Maine, which is a pretty, actually, mostly white state, there are many African immigrants from Senegal, from Congolese states, and there have been some escalating incidences, as are said here in the slide. So there really was a sense that there was just no communication and not just a fear but a disdain, that there was no communication between youth and that things were getting bad. And it was actually the high school principal that called Marty based on the work with the police and in some other city departments and asked her what she could do. There's a fabulous video online to see this issue. This is one of about five projects that have dealt with immigrant populations and the sense of neighborliness and neighborhoods in Maine. Also a project that connected the Muslim population in a different way. All of them involve engaging people in art making, making art product, and then bringing that product to the public in ways and places that can allow engagement and dialogue. It's intergroup dialogue first, and then community and external dialogue. And she's had a great deal of success. I would really commend her works, her website, Art at Work in Portland, Maine. So two plays were presented and performed, and you can see the rapport here right there in that photograph. So in the case of the police project, she used interviews with some of the leaders in from the union, from the department. She used written reflections, an anecdotal record, She looked at how the newspaper was covering incidents, and she actually looked at incidents as they were reported literally in the police records. She did piggyback into some surveys that were being done for community and internally to get some responses back in terms of morale and community perception. And by piggyback, I mean she found survey work that was already being done and was able to add questions related to that she was looking for information about into surveys so that she didn't have to do them herself. And lastly, she looked at actual records, around some of the significant data that would prove her point. And I want to go on. She had a lot of ways. She talks about quick, efficient ways to collect evidence. That is that she keeps a file for email so that anybody that's writing to her and saying, wow, I was so glad I saw that project, it made me see the police in a different light, went into a file, and she was able to literally collect those kinds of things for some content analysis. She noticed that the police themselves were keeping a record of all the coverage on a wall. This is the custodian's closet. That's his bulletin board, and he basically had a record of the program that he was keeping just by keeping visual images together so on. So just a few examples of that that I can share. I should keep moving here. I'm going to go back, and then I know I have to turn it back to you soon. So this is a municipal employee course that you're looking at, and you see the note that she includes opening and closing evaluation go-rounds with a specific question. So that question might have to do with, you know, what were you holding on to when you came, what are you holding on to as you come to this chorus rehearsal tonight? And then another question where they go around at the end and talk about perhaps how they're feeling. And so those are really quick captures that allow her to see what difference the participation has made. And actually, because it's very transparent, is engaging for everyone else. They are learning what the experience means to their compadres in the chorus. And so there's a really lovely way to really integrate that work. And I did want to close with the encouragement to just spend some time with this at first, but mostly just try it out. Like, just take one small program or activity and get with a few of your stakeholders and partners and start to have these conversations to identify what's important and to say, well, how would we know? And what do we think is current? And what do we think we would see if it really changed? I encourage you not to be so ambitious, not to make great claims that you can never get to in the short span. And lastly, I want to say that it's up to all of us to really add the evidence of our social impacts so that we can describe the work of the arts in more than economic terms and more than intrinsic terms, which are very important both. But we have to keep adding to the knowledge.
Wow, Barbara, thank you so much for this presentation. It was so rich, and I know you spoke to so many things that we're wrestling with here in terms of how we can realistically begin to measure social impact of the arts here in Ontario. And you've offered some really fantastic suggestions for ways of going about doing that in very nuanced and realistic ways. So thank you very much. I'm seeing here a note from one of the participants who said this is one of the best presentations. So
yay.
Just because we're at the end of our time here, I do want to say you'll see a slide right here for the Knowledge Center, and I want to invite people to think about how they might begin to apply this in their own work, and please share with us via the Knowledge Center We're going to send out a link to this conversation on the Knowledge Center. And Barbara, if you don't mind, if questions do arise for people, it would be great, I mean, via the Knowledge Center to engage mm-hmm. you in getting some responses.
Absolutely.
That would be incredible. Thank you. So I invite everybody to go to the Knowledge Center. You'll get a link via email by tomorrow. And I also wanted to share that we have another webinar coming up, and it was very funny because somebody on the line said, you should also check out the Arts for Social Change project and their evaluation tool. And I know Barbara is aware of this work that's been happening here.
It's an excellent resource. Excellent resource.
It really is, as is yours. We're very, very lucky. So on May 29th, Dr. Annalee Yassi and Patricia Gray will be joining us for a webinar entitled Evaluating Arts for Social Change and Community Engaged Arts Projects. And this is work that has come about as a result of the Arts for Social Change project, which was a five-year SHRC-funded research project on community engaged arts practices in Canada. And this online tool was developed, I guess, as their gift to the sector in response to that project. So that will be, the end of May. And lastly, I want to say, well, thank you, Barbara, so much for doing this work. It's really, it's always reassuring to know that we have so much in common with our neighbors to the south, and to see this really groundbreaking work that you're doing and sharing that with us. We're very grateful. And thank you to all of you who joined us on the webinar today. It's a beautiful day here in Toronto anyhow, so thank you for staying indoors when it's finally warm and sunny outside. I know that this is incredibly valuable, and a recording of this webinar will be available in the Knowledge Center, and we'll let you know when it is. So thank you, everybody, and we'll sign off from here, and hopefully see you again on May 29th. ¶¶